just about ready for our final presentation of USISA Support Services 2017. So I'm going to welcome to the stage this morning Paul Boag from Boag Works, and he's going to talk to us today about how we can start a user experience revolution. So please let me introduce Paul Boag.
Hello. So, you're nearly at the end. You've nearly made it. The last talk of the day. Hopefully, I won't bore you to sleep right at the end. And this is what you've been talking about, apparently. It's not about technology. It's about people. And that is exactly what I want to talk to you about today. But here's the thing. If we're saying that it's going to be about technology and not people, then our organisations need to change. We need to do things differently, especially if the people that we're talking about are our users, our students, our internal users, all of the various audiences that we need to reach. If we want to make a real difference to them, the way that we operate as organisations needs to change, and that's what I wrote about in my book, Digital Adaptation. In essence, as organisations, we need to become more user-centric. Okay, we need to start thinking about our users. The nature of our industry has changed, hasn't it? The nature of higher education has changed, partly because of the introduction of fees and students are beginning to see themselves as consumers, purchasing a product from you, partly because of the changes that digital itself has brought in terms of how we see the world and how we make decisions. Partly because now the last experience we had online is our benchmark for everything else. So you're not just competing with other higher education institutions in terms of the level of service you're offering, you're competing with Facebook, Google, Twitter, Uber, anybody else that offers any kind of digital service. So the expectations are incredibly high. Suddenly, the services that you're providing to students and the facilities that you are providing to students seem rubbish compared to Dropbox that's for free. It's easier to create a Facebook group than it is to use some internal system within the university. So there's a big cultural shift going on. And there are many organisations in many, many different sectors that are beginning to get and understand this, right? There's huge investment going in to design-led, user-led organisations. And they're massively outperforming competitors in the marketplace. So really, adopting a kind of user-centric, design-focused mindset is increasingly becoming essential to success. 89% of retail customers have said that they will stop doing business with a company after a single poor customer experience. That's how demanding and annoying we're all becoming, right? And that's us too. We're just as bad, aren't we? Right? We get frustrated and annoyed at other websites and digital services that we use. So we all know that that's the reality. Tim put it really well when he said most business models are focused on self-interest rather than user experience. I've worked with well over 30 higher education institutions now over a period of about 15 years. And if ever a statement applied, it was to higher education. Now, that's not a criticism of anybody working in higher education. It's the culture that has arisen. That students are just a slight inconvenience, really, to the business of running a university. Well, certainly, there are certain academics that I've met over the years that seem to have that kind of view. They're a way of generating money. But more and more, large organisations are recognising that you need to do things differently. We heard just a minute ago about how you need to look outside of your own sector and you need to look elsewhere for inspiration. And there is loads of examples of organisations that are completely restructuring and reorganising themselves to be able to provide added value to their users, to their customers. General Electrics have realized that they can take their core offerings and build all of these digital services around them that enhance and improve those offerings. IBM are currently in the process of hiring 12,000 designers worldwide to help improve the user experience for themselves and for their customers. And I'm sure you're all aware of the work that the Government Digital Service has been doing. And to be honest, this kind of all is fairly obvious, I'm guessing, that you know, I'm not telling you anything you don't already know. So the question then kind of comes up, well, why isn't this happening more, right? If the case for being more customer-centric, for being more user-centric, to building around people and not technology, if all of these things are fairly self-evident, why are they not happening? Well, the thing is that because it requires organizational change, that's difficult. Change is hard. We don't like to change the way that we work and the way that we operate. Culture, leadership, employee engagement are all essential to creating a great customer experience. In fact, what that basically says is everything is essential. Everything needs to be changed. Everything needs to be updated if you want to provide a great customer experience. So that's difficult. You don't do that overnight. It's a big challenge. A challenge that's made worse by the fact that we've got quite an uninformed leadership in most universities. That's not to say that they're not highly capable individuals. They are. But there is such a generational divide between your average, you know, vice chancellor and your average student, or even, you know, your average person on the street, to be honest, these days. There has been a fundamental shift because of digital in customer behavior, in the way people interact and people behave. And it's one that's very much a generational divide, right? So let me give you an example. My son is coming up to university age, so he'll be looking to apply to university soon. And he's very interesting. If you looked at my son, you would think his parents didn't love him, right? He looks like he's been dragged through a hedge backwards. His clothes look like he's found them in a dumpster, right? He looks an absolute mess, right? Yet, if you saw his avatar in World of Warcraft. Wow. He spent so much time and so much money and so much energy getting the highest epic gear. I don't even know what that means, right? And he looks awesome in World of Warcraft. He looks like a hobo in reality. And that's because in his mind, he balances, in his mind, there is no difference between physical and virtual, right? How much did your organization spend on physical buildings over the last 10 years? And how much did they spend on their digital environment? I bet your digital workplace doesn't even make less than 1%, didn't generate cost at least even 1% of what you spent on new halls of residence or new facilities. Now, there are lots of reasons for that. You can make money back on halls of residence much quicker and easier. But another big part of it is because senior management are of that mindset that physical is more important. There's a cultural difference. And truth be told, most of our leadership teams, most of your colleagues, don't understand this stuff. So what do we all do? What's the completely natural reaction when we don't understand something? Right? Especially when you're in a senior position and you're supposed to understand stuff. You bury your head in the sand and say it wasn't important. And it doesn't matter. So we've got leadership barriers going on. But we've also got very out-of-date structures. We've kind of taken the customer experience, the user experience, and we've kind of sliced it up into these silos, right? Just applying for a place at university, okay? Or even, let's take something as simple as day one. The day I arrive at university, if ever there would be a day where my hand would be held, where I would be nurtured and cared for and looked after, it would be that first day. But oh no, I have to talk to the accommodation department, the finance people, I have to talk to my course director, I have to go here and there and everywhere. And this happens all the time, that there's no joined up experience. And that's not even to mention technology. Right? Where there's this one group over here that own this database, and there's another group over here that own this database, and the two databases don't talk to one another because the two departments don't like one another. Right? I worked with one higher education institution that will remain nameless, who I swear to you, IT and marketing, I know it's stereotypical. I know you're supposed to dislike marketing and they're supposed to dislike you. But this was a comic proportions of dislike between these two departments. And when I drilled into it, it's like, why is this the case? Why is this happening? It turned out it was because of two people, the heads of those two departments, 10 years previous, disliked one another personally. Both of them had left. So we've got this kind of, we throw the user across from one department to another. And we throw projects like that as well, by the way. And then there's this culture, these unwritten rules about how we do things, right? I worked for another higher education organization that will also remain nameless, where right at the top of the organization, they said, we're gonna be digitally transformed. They didn't know what that meant, but they knew it was important, right? We're gonna go for this. This is our number one priority, is to focus on our users and provide a service and do whatever it takes, guys, and nothing happened. And then they did some training to teach people what that actually meant in practice and how to do it and encourage them some more, and nothing happened. And nothing happened because there was a deep-rooted fear in the culture. Something that wasn't the status quo, you'd get in trouble. So there are these unwritten rules, these official and unofficial cultural constraints that we exist. So it's quite a negative picture, really, and I'm sorry about that. This is the last talk of the day. Let's lift it up, make it a bit more positive. We can change this. You guys, sitting in this room, not someone else in your organization, but you guys can change this if you're willing to play the long game. That last talk was absolutely spot on. It was so good. There was so much in it that was right. But the thing that I really took away from it is the fact that if we're willing to play the game, if we're willing to participate and interact with our organizations, if we're willing to become the positive people of change, we can make a difference in our organization. And I want to share with you a very rough plan of how to do that, how to move above that wavy line. Okay? The first thing to do is you need to go and seek out like-minded people. Because at the moment, I know a lot of people in institutions, they recognize that there is a need to change, to do things differently, but they feel isolated. They feel alone. They feel like the only ones that get it. But in truth, you're not the only ones that get it. There are other people. They might not know words like digital transformation. They might not know words like user experience, but they know change needs to happen. They know that customers and students are struggling. They're faced with it every day. Maybe it's the people that deal with student calls. Maybe it's the people that answer questions or whatever. Or people from marketing that are struggling to encourage student recruitment or whoever else. There are people. And we need to break out of our little silos and go and find them. Go and search them out. Go out for lunch with them and network with them over lunch. Find these people in your organization that recognize that there is a need to do things differently in the institution, a need to change, a need to challenge the status quo. so you're not alone. You can begin to build a movement. But if you're going to build a movement, you need some shared values, all right? Your manifesto for change, if you like. And these don't need to be anything, it doesn't need to be anything fancy. It's not a business case, it's not a strategy document, it's not something you need to pore over for months and years. You just need something that you can unify round. So take that group of people and get them talking to one another and discuss some shared principles. These are the ones for the digital service, US government digital service. You know, of just basic principles in terms of how, what needs to change. How do we need to do things different? Now, there are loads of great examples out here of this kind of stuff. And just start talking about it, unifying together around this core principles. And then once you've done that, and you've got a sense of direction, now you start raising the customer's profile. And I'm using the word customer purposefully. I know it's a term that often annoys people in higher education, talking about customers, but I'm kind of doing it intentionally, really, because that's part of the shift in mentality that I think needs to go on within many higher education organizations. So there needs to be a general raising of the customer's profile within the organization. Do you have a clear vision of who you're trying to reach? Is there lots of little bits of data spread, you know, information about the user spread all over the place? Personas sitting in the drawer of marketing department somewhere, right? Valuable analytics data held in Google analytics that nobody knows how to interpret. Is there loads of big data sitting in some big database that everybody's slightly scared by? Or something sitting in a legacy system somewhere. Here's a question for you. When was the last time you guys sat down in a room and talked to a student? Brilliant. Wonderful. And that's the way it should be, right? In government digital service in the UK insists that everybody spends time with users at least once every 6 weeks, right? If you don't spend time with a user in the last 6 weeks, you don't get to be a stakeholder in a project. So now I'm not saying you need to jump straight to that level, but you need to start engaging and understanding your customers and your students and your other audiences that you're trying to reach and start promoting them across the organization. I always find a very telling thing when you go into a university and you walk around, the campus, right? And particularly when you go into, you know, the higher end rooms, you know, the boardrooms and the posh bit, right? Where it's got the nice big table and the nice flooring and stuff like that. Look at the walls, right? What's on the walls in that kind of place? It's often paintings of important people that died 200 years ago, right? Or new spangly looking buildings, ooh. Or important awards that you've won, right? The problem with all those things is they're internal looking, aren't they? They're saying, look at us, look what we've achieved, look how great we are. So here's a challenge for you. Create some user personas. Sneak in one night when no one's looking. And take down all of those pictures and put up personas instead. Now, I'm not saying you really do that. I in no way endorse that activity. If you get fired doing that, it is not my fault. Okay. But you get the idea. Look for opportunities to raise the profile of the customer. Start creating also a vision of the future. What would a better experience look like? Now, there's loads of ways that you could do that. It might be through prototyping. It might be through a customer journey mapping like this. There's lots of opportunities for ways to start showing people a vision of the future, of what better would look like. A group within Disney wanted the Disney executive to invest $1 billion, the Austin Powers number, $1 billion in completely renovating all of their parks. They wanted to introduce something called a Disney Magic Band, which was a little band with an RDF chip in, right? And the idea was that they could, you'd have this RDF chip, and with the RDF chip, you'd be able to do loads of stuff. You'd be able to open your hotel door. You'd be able to pay for things in the park. But also, it would know where you are in the park, which means if your little girl was having a birthday and you'd filled in the mobile app and, you know, obviously your ticket and all the rest of it was linked to this band, Cinderella now could come and find your little girl in the park, come up to her, greet her by name and wish her a happy birthday. Equally, the system could say, you said you're really interested in this particular ride, you're only a 2-minute walk from it and the queue's really short right now. Or you could pre-order your food at the restaurant, and as you walk up to the restaurant, the maitre d' would see your name come up on the screen because you've got the magic band on and say, hello, Mr. and Mrs. Jones. Have a seat anywhere you want and your food will be out momentarily. Meanwhile, the kitchen is notified so that the food is prepared and then they go and find you in the restaurant because they've got your exact location of where you're sitting. So they had all these grandiose ideas. Now they could have written a business case for all of this, but instead what they chose to do is take an abandoned warehouse on the lot and build a cardboard version of the Disney park. Then they brought the executive and they put bits of paper around their wrists and they made them walk around in this cardboard park and go up to the hotel door and say, now press your bit of paper against the hotel door. And someone behind this cardboard door went beep and opened the door, right? To give them a sense of what the experience would look like, what it would feel like. They painted a picture, a vision of a better future. Are you prototyping? Are you trying out new ideas? Are you showing people? But don't rush to get management on board. I think we've got sometimes this tendency to go back to the senior exec and get their approval for everything. Go back from this conference and go, I need to get them on board for my $1 million project or this great idea I've had at the conference. And in actual fact, this is quite late in the process. First of all, we need to win those people over. We need to get some momentum and excitement about the user experience and the need to create a user experience. We need to build some prototypes and try some stuff out so that we can get some data in place and put our argument in place. So by the time we go to management, there is such momentum behind what we're doing. There's so much excitement and enthusiasm that actually it's much more likely to be approved. But we shouldn't go in and we shouldn't just suddenly ask for our $1 billion either, because they're going to say no to us if we do that. Instead, we need to only get them to take the first small next step, to develop a proof of concept, to try doing things in a different way. And let me give you an example of what I mean. So many projects I encounter, let's take a random example, redesigning the website, right? Oh, we've got to redesign the website. We do that every 3 years, you know, through this boom-bust cycle. Oh, the website's great. Oh, now it's shit. Now it's great again. Now it's shit again. So this is the cycle we like to go through. So instead of next time, one of the reasons that those projects turn into such a nightmare is they get bogged down in interdependencies, don't they? Right? Oh, we need a new content management system. Okay, let's start a 3-year consultation process about getting a content management system. Oh, we can't finish that because we don't have the CRM in place yet. So we need to get the CRM improved. Oh, and by the way, we can't redesign the website yet because the branding is still being developed, right? Oh, and we've got to migrate 200,000 pages across from one website to another. There are so many interdependencies that it's compromise, 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 and it grinds to a halt. So let's step back from that and instead create a proof of concept. Let's say, let's wipe the slate clean, ignore all of those dependencies, and build a great customer experience and just see what that looks like. And yeah, we're going to have to compromise that later down the line, but let's not compromise on day one. Let's imagine what a better experience would be like. That's what Government Digital Service did when they created their alpha for gov.uk. It was free from constraints. It was a completely reimagined experience. And that's what I think many universities need to do. They need to break that cycle of complexity that grinds everything to a halt. And then in time, we need to establish new metrics, new ways of measuring success. For example, how do you know if your website is succeeding or not? Is it just down to the number of applicants you get? Or are you measuring things like time to complete a task? Or net promoter score? Or some other customer-centric metric, something that measures the customer experience? Because the other problem is we get into this bizarre situation where different departments have got different metrics that they're being measured on, okay? So I remember this wasn't a university customer, but it's a great example nonetheless, of a marketing department that was measured on the number of leads it generated, and a sales department that was measured on the number of leads converted. Seems very sensible, doesn't it? Unfortunately, the marketing department were the owners of the website because it was primarily a marketing tool. So they had the great idea of, before we let anyone look at our products, we first of all were going to insist that they give their email address over, right? Because that counts as a lead. So loads of people filled in these email addresses, and sales department had to go through and get rid of all the ones at Mickey Mouse Disney.com or some other junk email that someone had put in just to get through the firewall. And then they contacted each and every one of these people. Of course, 99% weren't anywhere near ready to purchase. But because of the metrics that were being measured, it was skewing the experience, creating a bad experience, and actually ultimately damaging the company. Another higher education example is once I was working with UCAS. And when I was working with UCAS, one of the things I was doing was helping them do digital transformation. And a part of that was an eternal comm strategy to help people understand what digital transformation was and what was involved in it. So a part of that, we decided to set up a blog that shared best practice. And we thought, oh, we can do that easy, no problem at all. I'll shove up a Squarespace blog for you. Won't take 2 minutes, right? No problem. Oh, it's all right, we'll do it because then it'll be on our card and you won't have to re-invoice us. Oh, sure, no problem. 2 weeks later, it hadn't happened. Why had it not happened? So I went back and said, what's going on? Why is this taking? Oh, well, procurement didn't want to pay on a credit card, and then legal were worried about the terms and conditions, and IT were worried about the security, and so it went on. Now, they did an internal conference later on, and I was speaking in it like I am to you guys now, and I told the story that I just told. And then right at the end of that meeting, this woman made a beeline for me. You could see her moving. People parted as she, you know, out of fear and terror. You know, I felt my knees go weak. She was like, whoom. She came up to me and said, I was the person that blocked it from IT. And I said, I'm sorry. And she said, I blocked it because what would have happened if ISIS had hacked that, right? And had put their propaganda on it. How would that have reflected on UCAS? And you might be thinking, sounds reasonable, actually. But you have, and it is reasonable from her point of view. If that had happened, she would have been fired. But what was the probability of that happening offset against the benefit that the business would have got from quickly and easily putting up a blog? So my point there is that we often, our metrics, the way we measure our staff, our appraisals, our departmental thing, all of these things can actually cause more harm than good, because ultimately people are going to worry about their own self-interests. We need to start building cross-departmental structures, working groups. I'm not talking about committees here. God, the last thing university needs is another committee, right? But working groups, right? Somebody from marketing, somebody from IT, somebody from student recruitment sitting in a room and working together on a prototype, creating something together, not discussing it, but producing something tangible. And then we need to start focusing on creating a better culture, on allowing people to make mistakes, to experiment, to try new things, to be more agile and iterative in approach, and all of that kind of stuff. So all of this has been a bit lechery, isn't it? Do you feel told off? I feel like I've told you off, right? That's not fair. So what I want to do now is just share with you a collection of quick fire suggestions. So these are things that I've seen. You know, I've worked with a lot of higher education institutions, and some seem to be more successful at this stuff. Some people seem to manage to bring about change and get stuff to happen, and some struggle. So what I've done is I've collected all the different things that the successful people seem to do, right? And I've put them together into this set of cards, right? So 52 cards. And I'm going to just share with you some of the kind of highlights, just the top 10, really, of things that seem to do that start shifting the culture and start moving how organizations think about the customer experience and about digital. So, number one, show, don't tell. Do you remember the example that I gave with Disney? A lot of people really struggled to picture what a better future should be looking like. We heard, didn't we, a minute ago about how you need to try things like VR. You need to try things like the Internet of Things. You need to see them and experience them for yourself in order to really see their value. Well, the same applies to your colleagues. They need to see what a better future could look like, see the potential that IT could provide if only you had the investment, if only you were given the freedom that you need. So we talked already, didn't we, about prototyping and about the power of prototyping to do that, visualizing the user journey of what a better experience could look like. What would the perfect student experience be like beginning to end? What could that be? And also even getting your internal clients and your colleagues to actually complete some user tasks, right? You know those things that are really difficult to do? The things that are really awkward in the experience? Well, get some of the stakeholders and the people who are resistant to change to actually try this. I had a great one once. I was working on a website years ago where it was a website that was aimed at the elderly, like 80-year-olds. And I was trying to communicate to my 25-year-old designer that you can't do nice, subtle grey text on a white background. They won't be able to read it. That if you pack all those links together, they're going to struggle to click on them, right? And it just went round and round in circles over this. And I just wanted to slap him round the head, but apparently that's not allowed. So instead what I did was the next best thing, and I brought into the office a pair of ski gloves and a pair of reading glasses, right? Now he had 20/20 vision because he was young, git. So I made him put on the reading glasses and put on the gloves. So I replicated poor vision and arthritis, and I said, now use your bloody design. That's showing, not telling. Anyway. Number two is encourage colleagues to get in front of users. Start running open usability sessions. Steve Krug wrote a brilliant book called Rocket Surgery Made Easy. I highly recommend it. And he recommends doing monthly usability testing. Only testing three people, not many at all. Just three people in the morning, every day, on the same day every month, and invite anyone to come along and watch them. And actively encourage people to see what it's like being a user using your systems. And record and share those sessions as well. Create low-light videos, all the pain points and the hassles and the frustrations that users make. And maybe in time even make those sessions mandatory if you can get away with it. At least for stakeholders who are involved in projects where you're the lead. But also start engaging with your colleagues as well. It could be very frustrating, can't it, working with other people that don't get this stuff. But we need to start educating them and exciting them and informing them And workshopping them with them is a great way of doing this. Because not only are you educating them, but you're also making them feel included and giving them a sense of ownership. The greater the sense of ownership they have over what it is you're doing, say a redesign of a site or a selection of a content management system or a CRM or whatever else, the more they're involved with it, the more ownership they feel they have with it, and the less likely they are to block it. So getting them actively involved in the process is really good. Get them involved in workshopping what the customer journey is like, what the customer experience could be like. Get them wireframing with you. You can also do something called the user attention point exercise, which unfortunately I don't have time to tell you, but if you Google it, you'll see it. We need to change a little bit how we see ourselves. That our job as technology experts isn't just to implement other people's ideas, right? The below the wavy line bit. But actually our job is as much to educate and lead as well. Lisa Reichelt once said, she was the lead user researcher at the Government Digital Service, and she said, 30% of my job is doing research. So 30% of her job is implementing. The rest of it, 70%, is communicating what she has done to other people. And I would argue the same is true with you guys. Your primary job has got to be to educate and inform people about the potential of creating a great customer experience. And there are all kinds of ways that we can do that. We should be sending out newsletters and blogging. We should be using guerrilla tactics like replacing the pictures on the walls and setting people's screensavers to be pictures of students and, you know, all of those kinds of weird things. We should be running lunchtime presentations, or even, as I saw Hull did, is anybody here from Hull? No? From Hull University, ran an entire internal conference around digital transformation. And they got people excited and enthused. And they were able to achieve incredible things very quickly as a result. But most of all, we need to get better at targeting the selfish gene. I want to let you into a shocking truth. Nobody other than you cares about IT. Devastating, I know. They only care when it's broken. They don't really care about it. They don't even care about the user, really. They care about themselves. We all do. Our agenda, what we want to achieve, what we want to do. So we need to find out ways of reframing the things that we want to do in a way that they can associate with and they can understand, right? So if we want to convince management that investing in creating a better customer experience is worthwhile, then we need to frame that in terms of the organizational objectives they wrote in the company strategy document. You know, that document you put in a drawer and forgot. If you're talking to the head of marketing, you need to talk in terms of the difference you can make to marketing by improving the customer experience. Always frame it selfishly and make use of data. Data is such a powerful tool for bringing about change. Establishing clear KPIs, but most of all, creating a new mantra in the organization of let's test that. So in other words, every time you're in a meeting and one person disagrees with another about the best approach, the response should be, let's test that. Let's work out what the best approach is. Let's try it and see, rather than discuss it endlessly. And then, as I said, it's about linking back to wider organizational objectives. But what you can do right now is start changing the way you work as a department and as a team. You can do things like, you can start a project, not from a functional specification, but from user tasks. What is it the users want to achieve on this, you know, in us providing this service? How can we make a difference? We can make testing a mandatory and required part of the projects that we work on. Not an afterthought that gets pushed out because we're too busy. We can establish some design principles in terms of how we operate and how we think and how we work as a team. We can create policies and procedures for prioritising work rather than work being prioritised by whichever senior dean shouts the loudest. Take time to consider how you're working and how you can use that to shape a kind of more of a concentration on the user experience rather than internal needs. And all of this should happen in close collaboration with colleagues across the organisation. Don't allow people to throw things over the fence to you anymore, right? Oh, marketing, we need a new microsite, or we need, we're doing a new event or campaign. Here you go, here's the artwork, get on with it. Don't let that happen. Get them embedded in your team. Get them to come and sit with you, even if they're not working on your stuff the whole time. But by putting them in the room, they're going to learn via osmosis. You're going to educate them via osmosis. And you can lean over to them and say, hey, what do you think of this? Are we doing this in the right? And there can be a backwards and forwards and a dialogue and a collaboration that is so missing. We have this waterfall. Now, I know you guys all know about Agile with a capital A, right? Because you come from a development background. You're all well aware of that. But we try and run Agile in your own little team. That doesn't work. If the whole team, if everybody involved in the creation of whatever it is are not part of that team, Agile's broken. So if we want to be collaborative and iterative and agile, we need to bring people in. We need to get them in the room and interacting, not in meetings, but in working together on a daily basis. We need to be interviewing stakeholders. We need to be embedding clients in the team. Have any of you come across design sprints before as a concept? Right, Google design sprints, right? This is a Google Ventures technique, all right? And it's a great way of bringing clarity to a project without writing some massive functional spec or having loads of committee meetings, but instead spending a period of time working together collaboratively on providing and producing the best solution. It's a great way of bringing about rapid change and evolution. And don't be afraid, finally, to make use of outside experts. Now, I'm not talking about paying expensive consultants to come in, people like myself that are massively overpriced, who swoop in, give a load of advice, and then run away before the consequences kick in. I'm not talking about that. What I'm talking about is quoting and using people like me, but selectively. You see, the thing is you've got a reputation problem in your organization, right? We heard about this in the last talk. You're not considered above the wavy line. And you need to shift that thinking. And one of the ways you can shift that thinking is by quoting independent outside experts that don't have an axe to grind, that don't have an agenda, that are considered more neutral and overpriced. So, oh, if they cost a lot of money, they must know what they're talking about. So just quoting and referencing outside people is so useful, and I'm going to give away some of my books that you can hand out to people later. So remember that this is a long game. It's all about building momentum in your organization for change. And really what that comes down to is almost like creating a political movement, right? It's about creating, getting, you know, enthusiastic people together. It's about exciting them, establishing shared values. It's about going out and campaigning on the, out in the organization with a clear vision of where you want to go, what future you want to create. And then and later, when that momentum is going, then you start bringing management on board. Then you start winning them over, because they will go with the flow when there's enough momentum behind you. It's about working on proof of concepts and beginning to restructure the organization to be measuring more sensible metrics and to be better suited in its organizational structure before focusing on changing that culture. Now, I know that what I've said is a massive, massive, massive undertaking. And you probably aren't going to get to see it all from beginning to end. But I want to leave you with this. Winston Churchill supposedly said, I don't know if he really did, but success is going from failure to failure with no loss of enthusiasm. I really believe that you guys can change your organization, that you can get them to take digital more seriously, that you can get them to start investing in creating a better digital user experience for your connected students. But it's going to be tough. And you've got to keep going, and you've got to keep fighting the fight. But it is possible, and I would encourage you to do so. Thank you very much. We've got time for a couple of questions? If we do it quick. All right, I've got three things to give away. I've got the book to convince other people, the book to help you bring about change, and the set of cards I talked about. So we've got three questions. Fast and furious, go. Oh, you just want lunch, don't you? You don't care about the books. Come on. Yes. 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 Who reads them? Yeah, what you do. Absolutely, you don't. More noise. Yeah, yeah, absolutely. It needs to be tied to something. Again, I'm covering so much ground, you can't go into a huge amount of detail. It needs to be tied to a specific project. So let's say you're doing a redesign or something like that. What you do is you send out one email across the organization to everybody, and you literally, all you say is, we're running this redesign project. If you want to be kept up with what's going on, sign up for this newsletter, and we will keep you informed about that project. All right, so you tie it to a specific project. Then people have got a choice in terms of the level of engagement. They could choose not to engage at all, and then you've got the excuse of saying, well, you were given the chance to engage and you chose not to. They can passively engage, which means they can receive the newsletter, see what's going on, and do nothing else. Or they then can actively engage and become involved in the direction and the future of the project. So the newsletter can operate as an educational tool in itself. It is, as you say, it's just more background noise. But it can be a useful component in a way of running projects in an open and transparent way that makes people feel like they've been included and consulted in the project. And as that came on Twitter, I can't give the book away to anybody, can I? So that's no good. Any more? Yes. It's very difficult. It is hard. I entirely accept that. A lot of the time, it's about defining what you need for them, right? What you specifically need, because yes, you might need their engagement in order to get their buy-in and their support. But there are other ways of doing that don't require them doing long workshops. You going to them often helps a lot. You going and sitting with them and talking them through where things are on a regular basis, updating and communicating with them regularly about where the project is, getting them to simply express the level of input they want. So I tend to go with, as I've already said, kind of passive and active. The passive people, what I say to them is, okay, you've got too much on your plate, just flag for me the absolute no-nos. Right? What must not happen on this project as far as you're concerned? And if it looks like those things are going to happen, then I'll come back to you and we'll talk about those things. Otherwise, I'll just get on with it. Right? And then there are people that want to be more actively involved, in which case you inform and keep them up to date more regularly. The other thing I'll do is just say things like, okay, I understand maybe that you can't do lots of workshops or lots of meetings, but hey, why don't you come and sit in our office for a bit and work down with us? It'll probably make things easier. You're not going to get interrupted as much when you're down with us because your whole team isn't there. You can hide away down at us and just get on with your work. But you're around if we want to show you anything. So no doubt those things will be going, well, that isn't going to work or that can't work. It very much depends on individual situations. But those are a few things that may work. Oh, loads of hands. Yes, sir. Yes. Yeah. With values, it's about establishing why you want to change the values, right? There's almost always a practical reason, right? So if we want to be a more agile, for example, right? Being agile is a value, but it's only a means to an end, right? You want to be more agile so you can turn stuff around quickly. So what you do in that kind of situation is you say, well, let's run a project in an agile way, and you'll see how much quicker it is, right? So it's associating the values back to something tangible. Right, there's a question there. Yes. How to get students to care? Then bribery. Seriously, students, you don't need them to care, right? You just need them to be honest with you, right? If they don't care, that's something we need to know, right? Okay, it may be with their website, for example, or digital tools. We don't need them to care. We don't need them to be passionate and excited about our products. We just need to make it as deadly simple and easy to use that it's as least hassle as possible. That might be the objective. So if that's the objective, if that's what we discover from our user research, then fine. Now, to get them to care about doing the user research, you just bribe them to take part in it. You offer them pizza, right? So St. Andrew's had the best approach. Anyone from St. Andrew's here? No, St. Andrew's got the best approach. They bribe them with the most calorific donuts you've ever seen. They're amazing. Anyway, yes, any more? There was one more, I think. Can we squeeze it in? Yes, sir. User testing, right? People, management will respond to one of two things depending on the type of person. We heard this in the last talk. Two types of people, analytical and emotional, all right? So what you need is a two-pronged attack. You need to be able to extract data that shows problem points with your site, all right? So here's a drop-off point. We're seeing a 20% decline in the number of people that are going from a course listings to the clicking on the UCAS button or whatever, right? Or downloading a prospectus or whatever your call to action is. So hard data. You then support. Now, what that tells you is that's telling you that there is a problem, but it's not telling you what the problem is. And also, it's not emotionally resonating. So it'd be great for thinkers. Thinkers will respond to that. But you then do some usability testing. Now, there are loads of great software. I can, if you come up to me afterwards, lookback.io is one that springs to mind. Usertesting.com is another one that springs to mind. That you can very quickly, very cheaply do fast usability testing. What that'll leave you with is a set of videos, right? And that set of videos you can then edit down, and unlike normal, you keep in all of the swear words and throw everything else out. So all of those angry moments, all of those frustrations, all of that, oh, you stupid website! All of that you keep in. That, combined with the data together, tells a really compelling story. Especially if you can then tie the data back to company objectives or monetary value, but that's a whole other conversation we don't have time for because I don't want to get in the way of your lunch. So those that have asked questions, except the last one, I've only got three things, I'm afraid. The other three people, sorry, thank you, come see me afterwards, but for the rest of you, hope you enjoyed the conference, and thank you very much.